You know, don't just take your pastors for granted, but when God puts you a leader that is full of the Holy Ghost, that's got integrity and that walks with God, that's almost unusual today, and I hate to say that, but having somebody like that is really precious, and I thank God that I have been invited to be here with you and just believe that it's not over yet. God's got something good that he's got in store for you. Can you say amen to that? Well, I said this morning I've been married for 51 years, just a little over 51 years, and my lovely wife's here. I'd like for her to come up here and just greet you tonight. I'll tell you, she can preach too. She's been the inspiration of my life. You know, when I went to Canada and I was preaching in this church, and our first service was on a Wednesday night, and I looked and saw her, and I don't remember anything else about the service that night. Just seeing her, and of course, you younger people won't know what I'm talking about, but she had the Jackie Kennedy hairstyle, you know, all teased up, and I just kept preaching to her the whole night. I have no idea what I preached that night. But all I know is I fell in love with her, and 51 years later, I'm still in love with her as much or more than I was. The day we got married, and I'm just grateful because she's been by my side in good times and times when we're walking by faith and never complained. And I'm just grateful for her. And you know, as I said, one day I watched God to do a work in her life because she was busy early on with the children. And I was traveling so much when she didn't get to travel with me as much. But I'll tell you, she got in the Word of God and she found out who she was in Christ. And she was raised in church. She was Holy Ghost filled when we were married. But you know, when you get busy, four kids, one right after another, you know, that's a full-time job. But she got into the Word and found out who she was. And so I started standing back and saying, who is this woman I'm married to, you know? But I'll tell you one thing, she's strong, she's bold, she's got faith. And I just appreciate the fact that she's here with me tonight and still loves me. Thank you. Thank you. Well, I'd hate to have to go through this training again.
Well, I don't want to train another one, so I'll keep you. I've got you just the way I want you.
Oh, no doubt.
Oh, I tell you, well, I'm so glad to be here, and it's such a joy, and thank you for praise and worship.
Yes.
You know, praise and worship is just my heart. And there's nothing like being in the presence of God for me. And, you know, through the years, he talked about this morning about circumstances that we can't control, things that happen in our lives. And all of us have faced, I call it life. Life happens. And we didn't plan for a lot of things, but things happen. But the one thing that we can count on once we're born again, that God said he would never leave us nor forsake us, but he would go with us to the end for the end result to happen that we are believing God for. And I am so glad that God has never given up on me.
Amen.
And I certainly am not going to give up on him because he's been so faithful to us. He's been faithful to our family. You know, there was a time that our sons were in the world, and it's like we were praying for everybody else, but it's like, what happened to our sons? And there was a time that it's like, God, do you even hear me? But you know, he did. And our sons came back, and it's like, it's better than it ever was. And this has been like several years ago. And so they started working in our ministry, and they are such young men of character and love the ministry, and they would do anything for us. They serve us so well. And I can see that in the pastor's children. We've privileged to have lunch with all of them today. And I was telling my husband, what a joy it is to see the bond of the family. because I know what it means to us. And when your pastors get back, celebrate them.
Amen.
Because
Amen.
They've been working.
Amen.
And maybe they've had a few days rest over there, but celebrate your pastors when they come home, because they've been working for the Amen. Kingdom of God. And believe me, when you're not at home in your own bed, no matter where you are, there's nothing like home. So celebrate your pastors when they come home. And, you know, God is just so good to me. He's so faithful. And I don't have words enough to say how much I love God. We went through, I don't know if he's going to talk about our son that got killed when he was 15. That's why praise and worship means so much to me. Because when I was going through the time after our son got killed, praise and worship was all I lived for. Because it as good a preacher as he is, it wasn't his preaching that brought me through. It wasn't other ministers that brought me through, but it was being in the presence of God and through praise and worship. In my own natural mind, I couldn't think of the words that I wanted to say. I wasn't bitter. I wasn't mad at God, but I know he would bring me through it. And so it's like I just didn't know the words to say. So I would sing in the spirit, and it strengthened me so much. And to be in the praise and worship service, I got so lifted, and that's what brought me through. And I can't encourage you enough that when you are going through a situation in life, there's no place like being in the presence of God, because he will never leave you nor forsake you, and he will bring you through if you will stand. A couple weeks ago, he was not in the pulpit, and I was in the pulpit, and I was talking about our roots, how our roots grow deep. You know, he was talking this morning about the palm trees, and you've all seen when the storms come, how they waver back and forth. Well, it's because of the root system. And if you don't have a strong root system, whenever a storm of life comes, you will topple over. But when your roots are deep in the Word Amen. Of God and in the presence of God, he will bring you through every situation. And I'm not going to preach. He is.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Well, let me just tell you about the stuff we got out there before I leave and or get started in the message, or I won't talk about it. I'll forget it. But I've brought three of our books, and we got plenty of tapes, or not tapes, but CDs and stuff. But we didn't bring that. I didn't come here to do that. But we did just bring these along. And these three books are all different and all special. And this particular one, Never Be a Victim Again, It has been one that people write to us and just thank me for writing this book, because I take you to places in your life to where you've gotten stuck or where you've been hurt and you've been victimized. When our son was killed, we could have been a victim, but we chose not to be the victim. We chose to be the victor. Didn't say it didn't hurt. My wife just let you know that it did hurt. But, you know, the thing of it is, when things happen, what you need to know is how to get through, not how to get stuck. And I talked about this morning of a woman that's a dear friend of ours, and I knew her before she was ever in the ministry, and you know, how that she was abused by her father. I have no clue of what that is like or how bad it could affect you in any way whatsoever, whoever it may have been. But this woman was abused by her father over and over again, and how she could have given up on life and did for a while. But one day she turned her life to Jesus, and God then took the pain of her life and she turned the pain around, and now she is helping millions of people all over the world. And her brother was right the opposite. I knew him too and tried to help him many times. And he blamed everybody in his life for his problem. He never took responsibility. But just about 3 years ago, they found him dead in a warehouse here in Los Angeles. He had the same opportunities that she did. She chose to get through her pain, and he never really ever had anything happen to him. She's the one that had the bad things. But, you know, when as my wife said, life happens, when it comes, you don't have to be the victim. You can be the victor. So I really encourage you to get this on your way out tonight. And I talked about this one this morning too. This is right and wrong expectations in friendships or relationships. I wanted to call it relationships, and the publishers wanted it friendships. So I said, okay, I don't care. But I think it's one of the problems in the church today, in the body of Christ, is people expect things from others and people don't know they're expecting. And so failed expectations in relationships is something that you know how to deal with. And, you know, I've got friends, you know, I've been in the ministry now over 51 years, and I've got friends that I started with. They're still my friends. Now, it hadn't been easy, but I just realized I'm not someone else. I am who I am. And, you know, I have a friend. He's an unusual friend, and just great personality. And my wife was one time doing a real special thing for me, and I didn't know it. And she was inviting my friends from all over the United States to come in, and I had no clue this was going on. And anyway, most all of my friends flew in from all over, and I walked in and was surprised. And she told me later she invited this other special friend of mine. Well, she said he didn't answer, and she sent him two, but he didn't answer. And so when she told me about it, it didn't bother me. It didn't upset me and didn't make me wonder, well, what's wrong? Why didn't he come? And, you know, just a few months later, his wife did the same thing for him. I got an invitation. I RSVP'd, and somebody said, why would you RSVP? Why would you go? He didn't come to yours. He didn't even acknowledge the invitation. Boy, you're really looking at me, aren't you? I'm not him. That's why. I went to his affair, brought him a nice gift. And, you know, a few months later, he flew into Dallas, where we live, and came to my home, and he was crying. He said, you know, I'm not the friend you are. I can't do what you do. Yeah, I just let him talk, because I don't expect him to be like me. If he didn't want to come to my deal, he didn't want to come. Somebody said, well, I don't want a friend like that. Well, that's your business. See, I've just learned that life is short. And you want to live it with God's goodness, and you want to spread the goodness of God over everybody you can. And if you let the stuff that happens to you get you all messed up, then you're not going to have anybody to show God's goodness to. And you know, my friend and I, we talk on the phone, we do things, we've done things in different parts of the world together. But you know, I just learned a long time ago, I couldn't expect him to do what I would do. And I think this is where even my wife, I can't expect her to do what I would do. And this has helped me so much when I learned. You know, how many times have, you know, you invited a guest for dinner, and starts getting close to time, you start looking at your watch, and you look at the table, you look at the house, and then if you hear something, you go to the window to look and see if you're expecting something. We see when you have a failed expectation, whether it's from your prayers or from a relationship, many times you don't know how to handle that. And so I talk about both in this book. And as I mentioned this morning, there's a woman wanting to get started in the ministry and needs some exposure for her name to be on my book. And so I told her she could put it on there. And Joyce Meyer put her name on my book so she could get some exposure. And maybe I can help her out and get somebody to know who she is. But actually, she heard me preach part of the message that's in this book. And she said, Don, if you don't write a book on that, I am. And she said, well, when I wrote the book, then she said, I want to do the foreword for you. So that don't make the book any better, but it does let you know I do have some good friends. Amen. And same thing in this book, Spiritual Growth. I'm telling you, I just sometimes sit down and read my book. I do. I just get this book out and read it every now and then, because it's such a blessing to people all over the world. And there's another gentleman who needs some exposure, and he asked me could he put his name on my book, and that's Rod Parsley. You know, the little preacher up there in Ohio that just yells and screams real hard, you know, and preaches all over the world. But this book is probably the most unassuming book that when I wrote it, I never assumed that or thought it would be, but it's just, there's over a million copies of this book now. It's in languages, I don't know how many languages, we've got record of it, but I don't remember how many languages it's recorded in, and it's simple. So this one's 10, this one's 15, and this one is 16, but all three for 30. So on your way out, stop, my wife will be out there, cash, credit card, promise, or check, or a kiss, or whatever you got. I tell you what, let me give those away. You want one? There you go. How about that? And you know what? I saw you. You're getting your hand. I just like to bless people. Amen. Amen. You know, I was in Manila doing a pastor's conference a few years ago, and we had 3,300 pastors there. And we were in this big arena, and just before I'd gone to Manila, a friend of ours called me and said, you know, if you'd like to fly up here where we are, you and Sharon, you can fly with us. I'm going to be on television with someone, and I want you to go with us because we're going to go to lunch with this minister after. And you can fly on our jet with us to where the television studios are. And so I said, oh, yeah, I looked at my schedule. Yeah, I'll go. She said, because I want to ask him to support your missions. And I'm sure he'll probably really get involved in your missions if I ask him. Well, I thought, yeah, this is great. I'll do that. And so, you know, in my prayer time, a couple of weeks later, I just felt like, you know, this is not something I'm supposed to do. I'm not supposed to go do that. So I called her back up and I said, you know, I really appreciate the invite. My wife and I do, but I just don't feel like this is what I'm supposed to do. I just, you know, it's a great thing, but would you not be offended if I don't go? And she said, of course not. And so anyway, a few weeks later, I was in Manila doing this meeting. And I got a phone call in the afternoon at my hotel room, and a friend of mine in Manila, he said, you know, he said, this minister just flew into town, and I told him you were here. Well, I didn't even know he knew me. And he wants to know if he and some of his team can come to the meeting tonight. I said, well, of course, you know. So we saved a spot, and he came into the service, and I invited him up to the platform to say a few words, and he looked around, and I was giving away 3,300 of each of these books, 3,300, one to each pastor, and I was giving away two, so that was 6,600 books I was giving away to each pastor. And then I had two books of Joyce Meyer's to give away that I had printed. She gave me the freedom to and the rights to do so, to have it printed, so I didn't have to go through her publisher. And I gave each one of those two of her books. And then Kenneth Copeland had given me some books to give away. And then I had 15 motorcycles on the platform that I was giving to different pastors that didn't have any transportation. And I'd like to have given more, but that's as far as the budget went. So when I invited him up, he said, I don't know what's going on up here. But he said, what's all these books? I said, well, each pastor's gonna get one, get them tonight. We're gonna give pastors these books. He said, well, here's yours, here's Joyce Meyer's, here's Kenneth Copeland. So where's mine? I said, well, it's a good question. I don't think you gave me any. And he said, well, you should have called. Well, I knew if I'd have called, I couldn't have got past the secretary. And I'm not going to call and ask anybody anyway. I'm not in the habit of calling and asking ministers or anybody else for anything. I've never had to do that. I've just depended on the Lord, and God has supplied our need. Now, this was the minister that I was invited to go and have dinner with. I would have been a flea on the wall or a fly on the wall or whatever, but God put it in a way where there was direct contact and there was no one else using their influence to connect us. Isn't God good? And so as he began to talk to me, and I told him what all this was for, and he said, anytime you want any of my books, just call my office. And I thought, that's nice. I just got to know how to get through. And so anyway, I just thought, I didn't say anything. A little while he looked and he said, what's these motorcycles? I said, well, we're giving them away to pastors. And he said, why only 15? I said, well, that's where the fun stopped. You know, we had enough money to do this and rent this place and fly my crew in and bring all this in. And I said, this is about as far as the money would go. And he said, well, would you like to give some more away? And I said, well, of course. And he said, how many? And I said, well, at least 50. And he said, well, how much will that cost? And I said, $50,000. He said, I'll give you $50,000. I'll buy 50 more. Now, what if I had gone before and this person would have said, here's my friend Don Clowers that does great missions. Would you support? He might have said yes, and he might have said no, and he might have said, well, we'll put you on the support. But you know, when God puts stuff together, not that the other wasn't God, but this was God putting, and before it was over, he said, here's my cell number. You can call me anytime you want to. You can get in touch with me anytime you want to. And then, you know, I was sharing with some of the family today, where's Ruth? Where's Ruth? And Ruth was talking about how she was in a missions trip today, and boy, she just... I mean, I did missions, really, really did it do, but you really did missions, you know. But I tell me again what y'all did. You know, I can't explain it exactly, but y'all just had to ride Jeeps, or what y'all do?
We went to Africa in military trucks.
Military trucks. And you know what that must be like, riding in that, you know. Well, we go places where Caucasians and has never been, or whoever I have with me, whether African-Americans, whatever they are, they're with me. But I don't go in until I send scouts in. And we have these scouts that'll go in. Sometimes it takes them a week to get in. But when they get in, they set it up, and then they get these places fixed for helicopters, and then we fly in. When I get there, we fly in helicopters, and we preach in villages that's never had the gospel or never had anything like that happen. And of course, I got to tell him about that. And then I said, this little gentleman over here, he was there. I said, he's one of the scouts that goes in and carries a backpack. And sometimes it takes him a week to 8 days to where he gets off of the transportation to get into where the people are. And he looked at him and said some things. And he said, well, I just want you to know, through your ministry, I'll take care of him the rest of his life. He was on my payroll, but that was something that we didn't have to do. We could put it somewhere else. See, I'm telling you, God will set you up so good if you'll just let him. Sometimes you work so hard to try to make things happen, and it's something, you know, that the support that came, that I didn't ask for anything whatsoever, but he was there offering, plus gave me the cell number, and we became really good friends. So I want to tell you something. God will make a way for you if you'll just trust him, if you'll just believe him. Can you say amen to that? Wow. God is so good, isn't he? Oh, I'm telling you, I just, you know, I'd rather be in the presence of God than anything. I don't know if I'll preach tonight or not. Is that okay? I might just talk. Is that all right? But I'd rather be in the presence of God than anything in the world. You know, Psalm 16:11, in his presence is fullness of joy. In his presence are fullness of joy. Just say that.
In his presence is fullness of joy.
Say it one more time.
In his presence, fullness of joy.
What's the rest of it say? Does anybody know? And what?
At his right hand, the pleasures forevermore.
At what?
At his right hand, the pleasures forevermore.
At what?
At his right hand, the pleasures forevermore.
Pleasures. You know, I'm a guy that's just probably unusual, and I've experienced a lot of things. You know, I started riding a Harley when I was 14 years old. Still ride one today, and I'm 70. Still have my own Harley and ride it. And I'm 70 years old, and so if you tell me I'm too old, I don't know it. So just mind your business. You know, I jump out of airplanes, I fly airplanes, I scuba dive. You know, it's just amazing. You know, it's really something to jump out of an airplane and you're free falling at 120 miles an hour. That's one of the most amazing things in the world to do. She said she might do one with me. I don't know. She keeps telling me she might, and so we may do one together holding hands or something, you know. But, you know, flying through the air really at 120 miles an hour is really a real good rush. You know, it's just really awesome to look down at the ground and, you know, you're just all out there. And it is just really something. It's kind of disappointing when the parachute opens in the sense because you slow down, you know. I mean, the parachute's okay. I mean, I want it. But, you know, it's kind of like the fun's over once you pull the cord, you know, and the parachute opens and the fun's over because you know you're going to be on the ground in a second. I mean, if it didn't, you'd be there less than that, you know. But my point in all that I'm saying, I'm just leaving out so much that I've been privileged. You know, I've been diving in the Red Sea and then on the Great Barrier Reef and just so many things that I've done. And you put it all together, and you can put it all in a handful, but there's nothing like being in the presence of God.
That's right.
I'd rather be in the presence of God than anything that I've ever done for a few seconds of rush. Because those few seconds of doing something or of a 30 minutes or whatever, you're under the water, you're not, you know, as long as you can stay under 45 minutes maybe, but if you can, your air tank will hold out and you don't breathe too much, you know. But going underwater, being all the places I've been, doing all the things I've done, never, you can put it in your hand and it's still nothing compared to the goodness of God. I remember one morning, you know, I get up early to pray and I got up extra early that morning and I went into my prayer closet and I was praying and I was just talking to God and it was just the presence of God was in the room. And my wife knocked on the door and she said, "Are you going to church?" And I said, "Well, I'm supposed to preach. I guess I am." And she said, "Well, you were supposed to be ready 30 minutes ago." She said, "But I heard these noises in here and I didn't know whether to come and bother you or not." Well, I didn't know I was making noises. And I wasn't sleeping, but it was like 9 something already, and I was already supposed to have been dressed and ready to go to the ministry, to minister that morning. But I'd been there since 4:30 or something, and I just got lost in the presence of God. I mean, the goodness of God was just, I didn't have any consciousness of time, because the presence of God was so strong, and as I said, I don't even know what happened those hours, because it was just so peaceful and so powerful, and I mean the room was electrified with God's glory. A couple of weeks later, I went over to Seoul, Korea, and I was preaching for Pastor Cho, when I was preaching there and ministering there, and then I went to Prayer Mountain and preached at Prayer Mountain. And then he and I were flying back together from Seoul to L.A. And so I said to him, I said, "You know, could I talk to you about an experience that I had just a couple of weeks before I came?" And I told him what I just told you. And he said, "Oh, that's nothing. That's the way I pray all the time. I just pray in the fourth dimension." So I think what happens is we all get so busy We all try to accommodate me. Isn't life all about me anymore? And so we get so caught up in me, we don't have the time to give any to God. For the most part. You know, I'm not saying everybody, but you know, we are so busy, the traffic and all the things you have to do. You say, I just can't do that. I think sometimes it's not that you can't do that, you don't do that. Because there's so much obligation and so much responsibility. But I'd rather, again, be in the presence of God than anything that I've ever done. I love to preach, but I'd rather be basking in the presence of God than to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. And the gospel of Jesus needs to be preached to all the world, but it needs to be preached with power.
Amen.
As Pastor Geneva said a few minutes ago, we need more than someone that can have head knowledge to talk about a Greek word, and that's okay to talk about Greek words and give you a definition or a Hebrew word, that's okay. But you know, what really matters is when you're touched by the Holy Ghost. And when you're touched by the Holy Ghost can do more in just the snap of the finger than I could do in all of my sermons put together that I've ever preached anywhere in the world. But the Holy Ghost can come and He can touch you and He can change you in a minute. I mean, He can change you in a second. And I just pray that God will touch somebody tonight. Father, I just pray in this room tonight that your glory will come down in this room. That there will not be a yoke. There will not be a bondage. There will not be anything that people will walk out of this room that's holding them back. But when they walk out of this room tonight, Father, the joy of the Lord will be their strength. The peace of God will be with them, Lord. The anointing of the Holy Ghost will be on them so strong. Hallelujah. Come on, just begin to pray in the Holy Ghost a minute. Begin to pray in the Holy Ghost.
Thank you, Lord. Nyanda ba man, yanda ba la man, ha ya ba la ba hoso.
You know, hearing the voice of God is so awesome to be able to hear the voice of God. Isn't it? You know, I shared this morning when our daughter was in the hospital, and this man I gave money to, and I gave him all the money we had. And you that hear, I'm sure you remember the story. But what I didn't ever finish telling you that story was, that was on a Sunday when I did that, when I gave all my money away. And the next day I was in the hospital, and I was in the waiting room, and the phone rang, and they said, the call was for me. And so I took the call, and it was a friend of mine, and he said, could you come downstairs and meet us? We'd just like to see you. And so I went down there, and there was about six or seven of my friends there, and they had a little pouch, a bag, zipper bag, and they said, we prayed for you in church last night and for your daughter's healing. And after we prayed for you, he said, I just felt like receiving you an offering. It was seven times what I gave old Cusser. Isn't that good? Seven times what I gave away is what they, and I had no clue that anybody was going to do anything like that. See, if you can learn to hear the voice of God, it's so important. You know, I was in Buffalo, New York one time, and my wife's parents lived over on the Ontario side, and while I was doing the meeting in Buffalo, I think I was in the Klein Hands Music Hall. It's either the auditorium downtown or the Klein Hands. I've been in both, so I don't remember which meeting. But I think it was the Klein Hands Music Hall. And it was the morning meeting, and I had finished the meeting, and I was driving from Buffalo to Niagara Falls. And I always, when I was there, I would go. There's two directions you can get to Niagara Falls, Canada. One would be right across the bridge in Buffalo, New York, right across on a Peace Bridge, takes you into Fort Erie, Canada, and then Niagara Falls. And that's the quickest and the best way for me, and cheapest, because you didn't have all the tolls. But I decided, you know, that's the way I was going, so I was in my car, and all at once this voice spoke up and said, go the thruway, the New York thruway. And I said to myself, I thought I was talking to myself, and, you know, I don't know about you, but I talk to myself a lot. And the reason I do that, I like to talk to a smart man. And I like to hear smart men talk. So anyway, I thought I was talking to myself. But I just kept going towards the Peace Bridge, and that voice spoke up again and said, go the thruway. And I just answered back, I don't go the thruway, I go the Peace Bridge. I mean, isn't that dumb? You know, you just talk it out like that. And so I kept driving. All at once, that voice spoke up again and said, go the thruway. And I said, okay, okay, I'll go the thruway. So I changed my direction and got on the thruway, was getting on the thruway. And just before I did, there was construction. And I looked over and I saw this couple. And before I knew it, I put my window down and I said, would y'all like a ride? And they said, yes. And so he got in the front and she got in the back, and they had a little bit of belongings and they put in the car. And somebody gave me a box of chocolates to take to my family, and it was in the front seat. And as we're going along, when we're paying the tolls, we didn't say anything to each other. It was just quiet. And because I didn't really have a heavy anointing in the service that morning. And I was just real quiet, you know. And so anyway, I'd paid a couple of tolls, and if any of you have ever been that part of the world, you know what I'm talking about. And so all at once, I happened to see that candy, and I said, would y'all like some chocolate? And I said, oh, yes. And so they ripped the box open, and you know, it was them kind that you got the little things, you take the chocolate out. And so they was helping themselves and having a good time with the chocolate. And no sooner they had finished, that boy spoke up and says, give them your money you got in your pocket. And I looked down and I said, they already ate all my chocolate. You want me to give them money too? I'm giving them a ride and I don't even know why. So I'm riding along, and I'm, you know, this voice coming back and forth, and they told me they wanted it out in Tonawanda at the River Road, and so I said, okay. And so we got down to the River Road in Tonawanda, and I pulled the car over to let them out. And so I reached in my pocket. I don't know, I think I had $100-something in my pocket or something, and as he was getting out, I handed it to him, and I said, God told me to give you this. And he looked at it, and he said, oh, my. Is that real? I said, yeah, I don't use counterfeits. So he took that money and began to tell me a story. So if you go out witnessing and you don't see results, or if you don't see them in church, don't ever quit. Amen. The seed you sow, you never know how it will grow. Amen. This couple had lost everything they had, and they had hitchhiked from Florida to, they were coming back home. And they were telling me their story, and they said, just before you arrived, we had gone over and knocked on a door and asked for food, and a lady ran us off of her porch. But just before you arrived, we prayed and said, God, what we learned in Sunday school if there really is a God, because they hadn't gone to church, they'd been out of church, they'd been away from God. If what we learned in Sunday school, there's really a God, send somebody to help us. I didn't know they prayed that. Isn't this something? If you'll learn to hear the voice of God. Well, I hand him that money. He and his wife came and they knelt down right there on the side of the car on the throughway, and we prayed the prayer. God gloriously saved them and baptized them right there on the throughway. The next afternoon, I saw him sitting in the service. It was a Sunday afternoon service, and I don't know if lots of people were there, but I came down, just walking down like I am now, and just happened to recognize him. Totally changed. So you never know by hearing the voice of God what will happen to you. I really encourage you to just desire to be in the presence of God, because in his presence is what? And his right hand is what? In his presence is what? In his presence is what? And in his right hand is what? And see, isn't it something? I just told you about like some of the things I've done. None of those things has ever given me the pleasure like being in the presence of God. Yeah. Being in the presence of God, being in a Holy Ghost service where God is moving, whether I'm preaching or not, it doesn't matter. Just so the presence of God is there. I'd rather be there than anything that I've ever done before in my life. Amen.
Amen.
Wow. Somebody say thank you, Jesus. You know, the Bible tells us in Deuteronomy, it says, God set before us death and life. Yeah. Choose life. So many times, death is at your door in many different ways, but it's up to you to choose the right thing. And I hope tonight, you know, I talked this morning about different things that happens to people, and then I mentioned, and I want to say it again, many people come and they hear the word, they know the word, but yet it's never been really revealed into them. They have had knowledge of it. And so when crisis comes, when hard times come, instead of yielding to the Holy Ghost and believing that he will take you through, somehow they get fearful, they get afraid, they panic, and in a sense, they're pushing themselves away from the help they need by allowing their emotions to become greater than the God that's on the inside of them. You know, when the scripture says, greater is he that's within you than he that's within the world, it's the truth. It's the truth. Greater is he that's within you. But it's a choice. You choose life. When you're in a death situation, things happening to you, choose life. Choose life. And what have you been choosing? Have you been choosing life, or have you been choosing the wrong thing? I'd rather choose life. Mom, I wasn't going to talk about this, but my wife mentioned a minute ago, you know, our son, 15 years of age, he said we were getting ready to, in this particular place where we're getting ready to do a big meeting downtown, and I had John Osteen come in and Marilyn Hickey, and I'm not trying to drop names on you. I'm just telling you. I'm not trying to impress anybody. I'm just me. I'm just a country boy from Tennessee that God just called to preach the gospel. I didn't know anybody and didn't have any influence. And God said to me, you're going around the world. And I said, well, I'm ready. But I didn't know anybody, you know. My dad was just an ordinary guy. He never finished high school. He was just a welder. And my mom never finished high school. She was just worked in a pottery for a number of years and became a homemaker. And so we were nobodies. But you know what? We had the Holy Ghost. Amen?
Amen.
We had the Holy Ghost. Somebody say, I've got the Holy Ghost.
I've got the Holy Ghost.
But God just called us into the ministry and, amen. Thank you. I'll tell you, that's good. That's a good echo, isn't it? Isn't that a good echo? I love kids. But you know, we were getting ready to do this big meeting downtown and in the big convention center, and we were going to use the PA that was in the building. And so my son said, Dad, can I go under the platform and see what it takes to get the all the cords loose and to get the snake out. And if you don't know what the snake is, it's a bunch of cords in a cord. And so he said, can I go under there? And I didn't think anything about it. I said yes, and I was busy, and he never returned. So when we found him, he was under the platform. And the building we were in, a beautiful building, but whoever had installed our air conditioners didn't ground them. And so when one of the air conditions quit working that we didn't know, instead of it kicking the breakers, it put all the power on the air conditioned ducts. And under the platform were air conditioned ducts. And when our son Jeffrey touched that, he was immediately electrocuted. And you know, this was devastating, being a faith preacher, being in the ministry, and just getting ready to do a big conference with many of the faith people coming. And, you know, it was a very hard thing to go through, a very hard thing to deal with. You know, you don't understand why it happened. And but we just turned ourselves to the Lord and said, God, you know, at the service, we didn't, during the service, we didn't have a sad service. We had a service. Phil Driscoll was there. I had him playing the trumpet, and some of you may know who he is. And, you know, he was blasting away the trumpet and shouting and prophesying. And we had others there just ministering the word. And you know, I knew he was in heaven, so why should we be crying? Now, that doesn't mean we didn't shed tears, so don't look at me like we were weird or something. But we didn't during the service. You know, the Holy Ghost, the presence of God came in that going home service for our son. We didn't expect it to be that soon that he had to leave us. But instead of us mourning in the service, we gave glory to God and we sang all praise songs. And nothing, I told all the speakers, I said, you can't say any negative things about what has happened. You just got to give God glory. We don't know why this happened. And so, of course, you know, when all the stuff was over, we were back to ourselves and alone, and we had to deal with the pang that we had lost. And some of you might know a man by the name, again, please, I'm not trying to use names to impress anybody. It's just people that's been in my life. And a man by the name of T.L. Osborne called us. I don't know if you've ever heard of T.L. Osborne. He was one of the greatest missionaries ever. And he called my wife and me, and he said, put Sharon on the extension. And he said, I want to help you, Don and Sharon. He said, don't ask God why. And I said, why? I wanted to know why. I want to know why this happened. I want to know how I didn't know and how I couldn't prepare for this or stop it. And he said, well, he said, I just want to tell you, don't ask God why. And he went on to explain. He said, you know, he may tell you if you ask him, and he may not. But he said, the best thing you can do is just accept the fact this has happened and keep loving God and keep trusting God and put it into God's hands and go on. And he began to share with us. He said, you know, you can ask God and he may tell you, but then you may not like his answer. And what if you don't like your answer? You're only asking for an argument. And I really meditated on what he said. And so after the phone call, we talked about it a lot and we went to prayer and we just said, okay, God, we don't understand why Jeffrey went home early, but we're going to give it, we give him to you. We sow him into your kingdom and into the heavens. And we're going to go on with our life. And we were in a lot of pain. I mean, don't look at me like, you know, what I'm telling you. We didn't have pain. We had a lot of pain, as my wife was saying. I didn't know what to say to God. All I knew how to do was pray in the Holy Ghost. So Romans 8:26, I really know what that verse means. For when you know not what to pray as you ought, the Holy Ghost knows what to say, and he'll say it through you. 1 Corinthians 14:14, my spirit by the Holy Spirit within me prayed, and it does it all the time. So we begin to pray in the Holy Ghost, and she would just worship the Lord. And that is how our healing came through this. It didn't stop me from preaching the gospel. It didn't stop me from praying for the sick. It didn't stop me from going on just because we had an unscheduled event that we couldn't stop. We didn't know anything about, and we didn't hear on that particular thing. See, some people just, when something happens, they just get mad at God. And she mentioned about our sons too. You know, that was another thing. We had one older and one younger. And the older one didn't get mad at God. He just said some stuff, you know, and said, I'm not going to go to church. I'm not going to live for God. And so, you know, he went to the world and he took drugs and alcohol and had them kind of friends. So my younger son followed his steps. And I mean, here we were going all over the world, doing these conferences and ministering and writing books and doing stuff, you know, and here our sons is out there in the world, just, you know, they got in the involved in the restaurant business, and this chef from San Francisco trained one of my sons, and you know, and they was out there in the world, and it was just, they had all the drugs, because you were in that business. They weren't in just little restaurants, they were in the gourmet restaurants, and so they could get access to all the alcohol they wanted, all the drugs they wanted, and here we are preaching the gospel. Sometimes I just wanted to cut their head off and tell God they died of an accident, you know? But I didn't. You know, I really didn't. I just kept loving them, you know, and loving them and loving them and loving them. And you know, my youngest son, he just despised the ground I walked on, and he got angry at God. He didn't get mad at me. He got angry at God, but I represented who he was angry at, and so he just couldn't stand me. And so until he wanted something that he needed and had to do with money, then he always wanted to come see Dad and tell me how much he loved me. But you know, the thing that happened, we loved them unconditionally. So when we lost the one and then the other two went to the world, I fought shame. But one day the Lord spoke to me and said, you know, you're not doing these things. You trained them to do the right thing. And they know the right thing. So I just turned it over to the Lord. Somebody bring me a chair, would you? Somebody that's good, there's a vacant chair by you, bring me a chair. Stand up here and help me a little bit. Hand me this chair. Thank you. Now, just stand there for a minute. You know, wouldn't I be stupid to go out the door like this and walk around? What would you think if you saw me at the airport and I'm walking through with a bunch of stuff on me like this, and you just heard me preaching at this church? Did you see that Don Clowers walking around with that chair on his back? I wonder why he's got that chair on his back. Well, see, Christians are walking around with all that garbage on them. And I was just about to pick up all that stuff from my sons and just walk around with my head down in shame. But God spoke to me, and he said, in the Word too, he spoke to me, and he said, cast your care on him, for he cares for you. And so I just learned to cast it on him. Just hold it there for a while. Where's another chair? Somebody bring me another chair. Put that one on top of it and let him hold it. What's your name?
Tyler.
Thank you, Tyler. Boy, give Tyler a big hand. They're not real heavy, but I don't think you'd want to go to bed with them, would you?
No.
They're not real heavy, but I don't think you'd want to walk around for 2 hours with them, would you?
No, thanks.
Well, you know, this is what we do as Christians, and we read the Word. We come to church, and I want to tell you, be in every service you can be in. Every time pastor, whoever he has here preaching, be here to hear the Word of God. And don't just have dull ears. Have your ears open. I mean, get the wax out and say, Lord, I want to hear everything you got to say. I want to hear it. I want it to go deep on the inside of me. And Tyler's getting tired. But just let
let God handle those things instead of you handling them. See? I mean, I may ask you to stand there for an hour. You think you can handle it, Tyler?
I think I can.
You think you can? Good. Well, God can handle it, see? But what we need to do is learn to cast our care. Thank you very much. Now, casting your care on the Lord is means you don't have it anymore. So my wife and I did not let the shame of what our sons were doing get to us or slow us down or apologize for what our sons were doing, because that was their decisions. But you know what? We stayed right where we're supposed to. We loved them two aggravating boys. Just, they were so aggravating, as I said, sometimes. And I knew what they were doing. And it just aggravated me because they were letting the devil use and destroy their life and use up time they could be using for God. So if you've got any relatives or loved ones that's out there doing the wrong thing, don't get mad at God. Don't get mad at them. You know, when people are under substance, you can't deal with substance. You know, dope, drugs, any of that stuff, alcohol, you can't deal with that. That'll just mess your brain up, you know. And so people get all messed up and people get mad at people, but just pray in the Holy Ghost. I just prayed in the Holy Ghost for our two sons. And my oldest one day called and he said, "Dad, my life's going nowhere." I wanted to say, "You're so right." He said, "You know, things are in a mess, and you know, this time he had two children." He said, "Things are just not going good in our life." And he said, "Dad, I know better." He said, "I don't know how I got in this world. I don't know how I got in this mess." This was 11 years since our son had died, and he was still out there. He said, "I don't know how I got in this mess." And I wanted to say, "Yes, I do. I'll tell you." You know, you just wanted to jump into all that. I just listened. And he said, "Dad, would you pray with me?" Thank you, Jesus. 11 years. Satan stole from us and from them. But 11 years, we started praying. The Holy Ghost fell on him. God began to change his life. And you know, this particular restaurant he had, his one of his head chefs was addicted to cocaine, and one of the other ones, he began to tell me, and you know, their bar was making all of this kind of money and they was doing all of this, you know, and so I wasn't in the bar, so don't look at me that way. My son was running the restaurant. So anyway, I said, "You know, Sonia, you just got to let God lead you here." So he began to pray. So he started witnessing to the staff. And the ones that didn't get saved, he didn't fire them, but they eventually quit. And he started, and right where he lived, there was a Bible school real near that had kids full of the Holy Ghost. And he started going to that school and hiring kids out of that school and bringing them in that restaurant. So the drink sales went down and the food sales went up. But the headquarters didn't complain, because the profit was so much on the food sales that they just thought it was a wonder that he could do this with the food. But it was the Holy Ghost that helped him turn things around and fill that place up with servers and staff to cook and to do everything full of the Holy Ghost. And it wasn't long till my other son was managing another nearby, and he started witnessing to him and turning him, talking to him, the youngest one. And so one day the youngest one came to see us and was sitting around the table, and I was getting ready to serve communion, and he hadn't had communion in years, and so I didn't know what he was going to do. And I read the scripture, you know, because you shouldn't be taking communion if your heart's not right with God. And so I thought, "Well, I'm going to serve it. It's up to you whether you do it or not." And so I looked over there, and all at once, big tears were streaming down his face. The glory of God began to come on him. And he said, "Dad," he said, "I know better than the life I've lived, and I feel so bad at how I have treated you over these years." He said, "I want you to pray before I receive this communion. I want my heart to be right with God." And he accepted the call of the Lord Jesus Christ to his ministry, and now he's preached all over the world. Isn't it awesome? Isn't it awesome if you'll just believe God? If you'll just believe God,
somehow. You know, he lived in the Philippines for 3 years, and most of the time he was there, he ran our office. But then God's just used him all over the world. My other son, he does all of our video. He's over all of our video. So I want to tell you, if you got something out there and it looks like it's not working, if it looks like something's not going to happen, just give it to the Lord. Let him carry it. Cast it on him, for he cares for you. Do you believe that?
Yes.
See, as I said this morning, let me say it again. Your revelation has got to be greater than your limitation. Your revelation has got to be greater than your environment. So when you hear the word, don't just get out there and do some kind of mechanical confessing. Just begin to believe God that you can confess God's word and speak God's word, and that revelation gets bigger and bigger on the inside of you. I knew our sons was going to come back to God. I knew that God's hand was upon them, and I knew God had called them, and I knew the devil had put an attack against our family to destroy our family and to black my name and to keep me from being what God wanted me to be and do what he wanted to do. But instead of taking on the shame and the guilt and all of this, I said, God, I give it to you, when he spoke to me. So I want to tell you, whatever is going on in your life, whatever the devil is trying to do to knock you down, just realize greater is the God that lives on the inside of you. Greater is he that's within you than he that's within the world. If God be for you, who can be against you? As the rain comes down and the snow from heaven. Oh, glory. The rain comes down, the Bible says. The rain and the snow comes down, and it doesn't return, but it waters the earth and makes it bring forth and bud, that it provides seed for the sower and bread for the eater. He said, so shall my word be that goes out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that I please, and it will prosper in that which I have sent it. My friend, glory to God. I believe in the power of the Holy Ghost. I believe in the anointing of God. God wants to do something for somebody here tonight. If you prayed and you didn't get an answer, if you believed and you didn't get an answer, don't get in a pity party and start feeling sorry for yourself because nobody shows up but you. So get out of that pity party and begin to glorify God and begin to magnify the King of Kings. The Lord of Lords. The great I am, the lily of the valley, the bright and the morning star, the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning and the end.
Hallelujah.
He's faster than the lightning. He's louder than the thunder. He's higher than the highest mountain. He's lower than the lowest valley. He's brighter than the sunlight. He's my rock, my sword, my shield. He's the wheel that's in the middle of the wheel. He's the strength of Samson, the love of John, the meekness of Moses, the holiness of Paul, the power of Peter. Oh, I could keep going right on talking about what he is in Genesis and Exodus and Leviticus and Numbers and Deuteronomy. I could keep on quoting all of them, but let me tell you something. I'm just trying to tell you that Jesus Christ is alive. He is alive. He's alive forevermore. It's more than a storybook. It's more than a black letters on white pages or red letters on white pages. It's the living word of God. It's alive. It's active. It's sharper than any two-edged sword. And if God is living inside of you, who can be against you? So it's time to look upon the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. I love what I do. You know what? I hadn't thought of this in years. Just came to my mind right now. But when I was a kid and didn't have no place to preach, I didn't go around asking anybody. I'd just go find me a place to preach. And I was in this little town in Tennessee. I was just a kid, just had driver's license. And this little town, actually, it's a little town named Athens, Tennessee. And it's between Chattanooga and Knoxville. And I'd driven down on a Saturday morning because I didn't have any place to preach. So I was on the main street on Saturday, and it's a number of years ago, you know. I was with these young people today, and just hanging out with this mature people, you know, and I'm thinking, why do these young people want to be hanging around with people that's as mature as we are? And I'm 70 years old. I mean, I'm not done. I'm just telling you, I've lived a few years. So don't think I'm over just because I'm 70. I got lots to do. Amen.
Amen.
And I bet I can keep up with any of you. I can just keep doing that. I can just keep doing it. So don't look at me like I'm old. Because I've lived 70 years, don't be thinking I'm old. You might be old. But it's been a few years ago since this story that it happened, you know. And Joshua was, it was one of those busy Saturdays. Everybody was there in this little country town. So, man, I had my Bible opened. And back then, I had one speed, full blast, nonstop. And goodness gracious, these memories are coming to me. I'm sitting up here talking. But I just started preaching, and I mean, I was anointed. I don't know what I said, looking back now, but I said what I knew to say. And nobody was stopping. Nobody was stopping. And these two little, well, it was a woman, it may have been the daughter, I don't know. But anyway, one was a little more mature than the other. See, I don't like to say old. But one was mature and one was younger, so it might have been a mother and daughter, I don't know. But they kind of got slow as I was preaching, you know. I'm thinking, they're going to stop and help me get a little crowd here while I preach, you know. But they walk right on by. And I was standing in front of a furniture store, and I just kept watching them, you know. And they went around the side and stopped and listened to me. Well, that ticked me off. Because they wouldn't stay and listen there. They went around the corner. And I could see them over there, and they was trying to agree with me, you know. And I thought, well, why in the world won't they come out here and help me, you know? But I thought, well, this is not going anywhere. Lord, help me out here. I drove all the way down here from Chattanooga, and I just believe some people ought to get saved today. And I looked, and there was this old Chevrolet sitting there, and it had one of them kind of back ends on it. Wasn't one of them square ones. I thought, I bet I could run up that car. So I'm still preaching, going 90 miles an hour, you know. And so I ran up that old Chevrolet and stood on top of it. And I kept preaching. With them two little ladies, they come out and started, you know. I mean, people just started coming from everywhere. I mean, the people, the traffic stopped and was a big traffic jam. And I had people everywhere. I mean, I had people everywhere. And I preached till I finished. I don't know how long it was. But I got through. And I gave the altar call, and I said, you that's standing up real close, can you push back so these that want to come and accept Jesus can come to the altar? And people started pressing through from everywhere to come down and receive Jesus as their Savior and their Lord. So you see, that's how God opened doors for me. I mean, you know, my pastor wouldn't let me preach, and I don't blame him, I wouldn't either. He was such a good man, but he'd say, son, just go out, just go out. I said, when are you going to let me preach here? He said, well, you go clean the toilets when you're here, and you help with the janitors and those people. He said, you're not ready to preach. Well, I could have got mad at him and said, you don't know nothing about the move of God. But he knew I needed a little fixing, you know. He knew that I wasn't ready to get up there. And so I just go preach. One day I was in my bedroom, I was in my bedroom and I'd been praying. You know, and my mother was a great prayer warrior. Mother just prayed all the time. And nobody was home but me. My bedroom was on the top floor. And we lived in a little area there where the houses was all around us. And back then, people didn't have air conditioning. So it's in the summertime and everybody had their windows up. And I just bought something like this Fender amplifier. Of course, it was an old one, but it was something like this. And I got a microphone, and because this was self-contained, I'd preach on the street so much, and anywhere I could get a place to preach, I'd use that to preach with. And I'd paid $25 for it. It was a used one, and I'd paid $25 for it, and had to make payments on it to get it paid, but I did. And but I was praying in my room, and I got this idea. What if I put that amplifier in my window and preach to my neighbors? Wonder what would happen. So I did. I put it up there, cranked it up as much as I could, and had a microphone and the cord, and you know, and I got anointed, and you know, you think I'm pacing now. I mean, I'm slow now compared to my pacing then. I mean, when I was back and forth. Well, somebody called my mother. I don't remember where she was. Somebody called my mother and said, "Don's preaching, and the loudspeakers are so loud. You need to get home and get him, and he's going to get put in jail." And of course, I didn't know any of this was going on. So I was preaching. I mean, the anointing was falling. And of course, I said, when I come on, I said, "Hello, I'm Don Clowers from 4109 9th Avenue. And I said, I'm your evangelist today. And so come out of your houses, sit on your porch or in your yard, anywhere you'd like. And I'm going to break the word of God to you today and just bless you. And I just believe he's going to set you free and heal you and bless you and meet all your needs, whatever they may be." And I didn't see anybody. I was in my room, you know, but I just had that up there. And so, I mean, I was going, again, 90 miles an hour. And so I saw my mother come in, and I thought, man, this is a delight. You know, now, my mother was old-time Pentecost. And if you don't know what that was, don't ask me. And my mother was old-time Pentecost, and she shouted. You know, when we'd go downtown on Saturdays when I was a little guy, we'd go downtown on Saturdays. Mother had several sisters in the church, and, you know, they had that long hair. And, you know, it would, when they shouted, you know, they would do these things, you know. And, but we would be downtown on Market Street, and Mother would see Sister Collins coming, and maybe Sister Smith would be coming, and then there was Sister Jones. There was four of them, and they would just talk in tongues and do this all the time, you know. And lo and behold, it's a Saturday morning. We're on Market Street right in front of Sears. And here comes Sister Smith and Sister Jones and Sister Collins all at the same time. And Mama saw them. Boy, they was coming. And they were talking in tongues. Doing that, you know. And man, I ran over, started looking over here. I didn't want anybody to know I was with that bunch. You know, I was just a kid because I thought, well, these women are just really religious crazy or something, you know. But man, they hugged each other and talked in tongues and just had themselves a Holy Ghost time. They didn't care. So as I grew up, I got Mama's spirit on me, you know. And anyway, Mama come in, and when she come in, I thought, man, I got me a prayer warrior here. This is going to go double time. Man, I'm going to be like a Elisha. I'm going to have a double portion. Mama came to pray, and she's down praying. Oh, God, stop him. God, stop him somehow. Well, you know, I was raised in Pentecost, and the louder she was getting, I thought that was what I was supposed to do. I got louder, too. So the louder Mama got, she started praying in tongues, and so I started preaching in tongues. I mean, it was just back and forth. Mama saying, stop him, oh, God. I didn't know what she was saying. I thought she was saying, anoint him, oh, God, you know. She kept praying, and I kept preaching. Finally, I ran out, and when I ran out, I gave the altar call, and I said, anybody want to come down and stand in my yard and give your heart to God? Well, you know, neighbors just started pouring out from all over. Come right down there and stood in my yard and accepted Jesus as their Savior and Lord. I'm just simple. I'm just simple. I just believe God. Amen.
Amen.
I just believe God. So that's how I got started. And I'm here today. 50-something years later, still doing the same thing. It doesn't matter to me if I'm somewhere and it looks like that's the place you ought to be preaching. I just decide I'm going to do it. I don't ask anybody all the time. So you see, I've never changed. And God opens the door. It's miraculous how God will open the door.
Yeah.
You know, I was praying one day and I said, Lord, I want to go to this particular country, and if it's your will, just let me know. And boy, the urge just got stronger and stronger. And so this couple took me out to eat, and we're sitting there, and I had no clue. I've never asked, but it's just sitting there. Joshua's just sitting there. We're just having conversation. They said, what's on your heart? Where do you want to go? What do you want to do? They're asking. Shouldn't you tell? I said, okay. They said, well, you know what? We've really been praying about this, and we're just going to give you $1 million to do that. Isn't that nice? Don't look at me that way. See, I'm just simple, but God just answers me in simple ways. But he blesses when he answers. And so I did this huge outreach in this ministry, and multitudes of people came to the Lord Jesus. And so a few months later, we were somewhere, and we were sitting and having lunch again. And I said, man, I said, you know, that we saw the video, and that was so awesome. What else do you have in your heart? You're asking. You know what? They did that for 7 years. Every year it was $1 million for 7 years. Isn't that awesome? So don't look at me and say, you're bragging. I'm not bragging about anything. I'm just telling you, if you'll believe God, if you trust Him more, as I told you, my mother never finished high school, neither did my dad. We were just ordinary people. I'm the ordinary guy, and I still am. But God will just open the windows of heaven and put me at the right place at the right time. And you know what Acts 10:38 says? God is no respecter of persons. He'll do for you the same that He's done for me. Oh, shut up. That's my timer. You know what it says? It says done. I'll just press okay. You see, I preach in so many of these churches, sometimes they give me 29 minutes to get it done. Sometimes it's 23. Well, you have to preach fast. But I'm not done. The Holy Ghost has got something for you. And God told me to just tell you He's no respecter of person. And as God has opened the windows of heaven for us so many times in our life, when we were at the end and we didn't know what to do, God has brought somebody in my life that I never asked for anything. Never asked for anything. And somehow God will just open the windows of heaven and do a miracle. And He told me He's going to do that for you. I don't know what it is that you're asking for, but I want to encourage you. You know, I've been to Romania several times. And see, I just go and do our conferences, and we just invite people, and they come. I go to countries I've never been in there before. Nobody's ever heard my name before. I've never heard their name. But God just does miraculous things. Like your pastor is out doing, I don't know if people's heard his name or not, but he's just doing miraculous things because he's just believing God. Right. Support your pastor.
Amen.
He's doing the work of God.
Yes. Amen.
Amen.
Yes. Amen.
And you know,
last year, this year, but it was last year when I just had this desire to go back to Romania and do a conference there for pastors and ministers. And I looked at the budget and it just wasn't there. And I was preaching a convention in a conference, and a number of ministers was there, and this guy from Romania was there, and I said, go back and set it up. And he's worked for me for a long time, and he knows, because my son is not doing that at the moment. He used to be the one to set up all of our meetings. I said, go back and set it up. And of course, my son had taught him how to do it, and how to rent the venues, and how to get people together. And so he went back, and he said, well, I need some money. I said, just go. I'll get you the money. Out of the clear blue, someone called me. And it was the same one that had given me $7 million. They give me more, but in a year, for 7 years, gave me $1 million. Not me personally, the ministry. I was just home minding my business. And I looked down at my phone, and I saw who it was. I said, I think I'll take this. I don't think I'll let it go to voicemail. No, I'm just kidding you now. But I answered the phone, and they said, we just had you on our heart. Is this something God's telling you to do? And I said, yes. And they told me. I told them what it was, and they said, you know, we want to support that. We want to give you the money to do that. How much does it cost? I told them, they said, okay, you'll have a check. But you know what, folks? Now, this is big. It wasn't the largest meeting I ever had, but the largest attendance is not always the greatest. But I want to tell you something. What's your name?
Bill.
Bill. Out of 50-something years of ministry, it was the greatest conference I've ever had in my ministry. It wasn't the largest, but it was the greatest. And I'm standing here so full of gratitude of how God just puts things together. You know, you've got a wonderful pastor, but how God just brought us together. He called me up. I'm home minding my own business. No, he didn't call me up. He sent me a Facebook note. Would you come and preach when you're in the area? It just so happened I had to be in Newport Beach, and these dates worked out. And here I am. This is the way God orchestrates our life. We went to Romania. We had so many miracles in Romania. God put me on television there in Romania, in Timișoara, the capital, and it's where the revolution started. Communism was broken down, and I didn't do anything but just believe God. I didn't do anything but just believe God. You know, I was going to preach again tonight. I can preach, folks, but when I get to talking about God and His goodness, God just opened the windows of heaven. We had 30 pastors to come from Hungary. Now we're going to be going to Hungary. Would you believe that person called me up again? I said, what's in your heart? I said, well, just Eastern Europe has really been in my heart. Eastern Europe, the people just need Jesus, and the pastors need help. And my wife, I mean, she gets up there and preaches to the, you know, so many of the women in Eastern Europe that their husband's in ministry, they're just kind of standing in the background. But my wife gets up there and she's bold, and she just starts telling these women in the Holy Ghost and laying hands on them. They start falling under the power of God. And God's just changing their lives. Well, as I said, when I wanted to go to Hungary, this same person called me up and said, what's in your heart? We want to support that. Let me tell you something. Why get stuck in an unscheduled event? When an unscheduled event can cause you to stay stuck the rest of your life, and you can live your life through that event. Or you can say, this is a moment in time that God's grace is greater than this moment in my life. Your grace is going to take me through. See, our son, it hurt us so badly, but we realized
This was a time of loss for us, but it was a gain for him. He's in the presence of the Lord where we're all trying to get to. So when these things have happened to us, instead of us being stuck where we are, we let the Holy Ghost take us to the next place. See, I'm a nobody. I was a nobody. Nobody knew my name. In many places in the world, they still don't. You didn't even know me. I didn't know you. But you know what? There was a man hiding in the wine press with the wheat. His name was Gideon because he was afraid of the enemy, and so he was hiding. But God said to him, "Why are you hiding?" He said, "You ought to know why. This is my lingo now. You ought to know why I'm hiding. The enemy's out there to get me." God said, "You don't have to hide. I've made you a man of valor." Well, if I'm a man of valor, God, then why am I going through all of this? Why am I having to shift the wheat in here? Why am I having to do this in here if I'm a man of valor? God said, "My hand's on you, Gideon. You're a man of valor." I want to tell you, don't be given in to insecurity. Don't be given in to all of that garbage that's been spoken over your life. Don't be given in to all of those detours that you've been on. Don't let all of this negative stuff that's happened to you to start believing that. Believe God's word. See, I could have, because of the bad stuff we've had to us, I could have got mad at God and been angry at God and said, "God, your word is not true." I could have said all kinds of garbage. But you know what? I realize there's a devil out there that hates me. He hates everything I stand for, and he's doing everything he could possibly do to wedge himself in, to get us to quit, to get us to stop. But everything he does to me, I just put the pedal to the metal. I just keep on going. Somebody say, "Thank you, Jesus." So I want to encourage you, when it gets rough, when things look wrong and it looks like nothing's happening, don't get mad at God. You can't change God. You can't knock him off of his throne. No matter how mad you get, I hear people cuss God. But God just still be. See, no matter what's happened in your life, you know, people lose loved ones and they'll say, "God, why?" Start getting mad at God. That's the wrong thing to do, to get mad at God if a loved one goes to heaven. You know, just don't do that. We didn't. God will provide. Gideon was a nobody. And Gideon said, "Okay, Lord, I'll do what you said." And you know the first thing he did? He went and gave an offering. Mm-hmm. First thing Gideon did. Look in Judges and you'll see where first thing he did, he went and gave an offering. Fixed an altar, put an animal there, and gave an offering. Isn't it something? Here was a nobody that God said, "Don't you be calling yourself nobody because you're..." He said, "I'm the least of my family." See, you may feel that way, and that's the way I felt. I'm just this little country boy, and I was a nobody. I was shy. I didn't mix real well, you know? But when the Holy Ghost came on me, I was 15 years old when the Holy Ghost came on me. And it's just like Pastor Geneva was saying, you know, we have them all-night meetings, and boy, I'm telling you, the power would fall, the glory would come, and I'm telling you, I just soaked in the presence of God. I just love being in the presence of God, and God's always just... open the right door. He's put me at the right place at the right time. Everybody say, "The right place at the right time."
The right place at the right time.
Everybody say, "The right place at the right time."
The right place at the right time.
You know that minister that flew into the meeting and came to it in Manila? He said, "You know, I just couldn't sleep the other night, Don. I just couldn't sleep the other night." And he said, "I've been wanting to open an orphanage," and said, "I just called up my staff and told me to book tickets to go to Manila. I don't know why." He thought he was coming to open up orphanages, which he did, but God sent him there for another reason. See, God's got you in mind. When you were waking up, he was sick. What's your name?
Leslie.
What?
Leslie.
Leslie. He was saying, "Leslie, while you've been sleeping, I've been keeping things together for you, dear."
Fill her up, God. Fill Leslie up, Lord. Fill her up. Woo! Come on, Leslie. Fill her up, Lord. When you wake up in the morning, he's still just going to be there with his arms folded, saying, Leslie, I've been holding things together while you've been taking a nap. Woo! God's thinking. See, God's thinking about you all the time. People are running around here worrying and worrying and worrying, and God's not worrying. Don't look at me like I'm crazy. I might be by the world's standards, but I'm in the Holy Ghost. And when I'm in the Holy Ghost, who in the world has got somebody coming to them and taking them out to eat and giving them $1 million? So don't be laughing at me. That's good, isn't it? Woo! That's so good. That's better than a skydive, isn't it? Woo! My wife called me up the other day and she said, you want to know something funny? I said, yeah, I sure do. She gave me the news. It wasn't funny at all. She was just laughing and laughing and laughing. My lightning fast mind finally got it. Something we couldn't do anything about. It's an unscheduled event. She was laughing about it. I'm sitting there and I was preparing for a meeting somewhere or a television broadcast or something. I don't remember what I was doing, but you know, I was all engrossed in what I was doing. And when she told me that, and she said, you want to hear something funny? And I thought, yeah. And I'm thinking to myself, how could that be funny? And she's just laughing. The Holy Ghost was on her. So I just started. I got just like Leslie. I sure wasn't happy about the news I got. Yeah, and she's going. I just started laughing. Well, it didn't change my situation at all for the moment, but it changed me. I didn't go to the office that day. I was busy working at home. She came home, and she came in. I just hugged her up real good, and we just stood there laughing in the Holy Ghost. But you know, about 3 days later, God more than fixed the problem. God more than, but you say, what if I hadn't have let the Holy Ghost take charge? I'd have been trying to fix the problem, and I didn't have the ability to fix the problem. Get some more. We may have you go around here and lay hands on some others and give it to them. Somebody say praise the Lord. Well, you know, I was thinking about Gideon, and I won't go through the whole story, but I think about how he went through the whole process of eliminating all of the unbelievers. That's what I call it. So sometimes big does not mean it's the best. Sometimes. So God would just tell him, eliminate all these unbelievers, you know? So he wound up that he had 300 believers. 300 believers left. So if you see a few people running off, let them go. They're not in your destiny. Let them go. God's just shaking off the tree and getting it ready where the Holy Ghost can start flowing through you without somebody standing over there. What are they doing? I mean, if he was over there looking like this, they may say, ooh, isn't that beautiful? No. God Come on, Nicolette. Just go ahead and drink it. Just drink it in good. Drink it in good, Nicolette. That fun? And you'd rather see somebody do that than say, oh, I don't know what I'm going to do. God, where are you? How come you're not fixing my problem? How come you're not helping me, God? I don't understand this, God. I look over there and she's got her blessing, but mine didn't come. And I did this and I did that and she's done nothing. Oh, shut up. Just start laughing like Nicolette and Leslie. Like I did. And start eliminating unbelievers and get 300 believers together. Ooh, what can you do when you get 300 believers together? Well, God told Gideon what to do. And there was 300 and there was 300,000 of the other ones. I mean, that doesn't seem right, does it? Does that sound like smarts? That doesn't smell like good smarts, does it, Bill? But God told him, said, take a ram's horn in one hand and take this jar in the next hand. And this jar's got a light in it. And when I tell you, break the jar, Gideon said, when I tell you, break the jar and hold the light up and blow the ram's horn with the other hand. Just keep on. You're not bothering me at all. Have a party for my party. Somebody said, how can you talk and somebody over there laughing like that? Well, I'll tell you, I like it myself. She's not crying. She's not complaining. Do you know what complaining is? Complaining is finding fault. Some people, they just complain. I don't have time to complain. I want my problems fixed. The more I complain, the worse they get. But the more I rejoice, the more the knowledge and the wisdom comes of how to fix it. Why don't somebody get happy? Why don't somebody rejoice? Why don't somebody let God fix you? Quit complaining why it's not done. Jump in the river. I don't know what that was, but you can do it again if you want to. Somebody said, and that's church. Yeah. See, Gideon run the unbelievers off. But look what 300 did. They blew the ram's horn with one hand and they held the light in the other. But now, see what the secret is. Back in those days, one light and one trumpet or ram's horn represented 100 people. One light and one ram's horn blowing represented 100 people. There was 300 that had a ram's horn and that had a light. And God told Gideon, put some over here and scatter them. Put some over here and scatter them. And put some over here and scatter them. So here these 300 people were all around. And when they broke their clay pots and the light began to shine and they began to blow their horn, the army understood how it works. So instead of it being 300, they thought it was 300,000. So when the 300 trumpets begin to blow, they thought 300,000 were coming after them. So they begin to devour themselves. See, you worry over the enemy and get caught up in his camp when God's trying to tell you, greater is my power that's within you than he that's within the world. We can change this world. You know, in the 80s, I went into a very, very poor country and I was preaching in this guy came down and got saved. And I support missionaries, but I train them too. The locals, I train them. You want to laugh about this now? I train them that the God that I serve is a supplier in whatever country it is, just as much as America. Now, I know overall we're more plentiful, but in all of the countries, there's a lot of money in all the countries. It's just a few people that have it. But that cycle has to be broken.
Amen.
So when I go into a country, again, just me, I just go in. But when I step my foot on that ground, I claim every inch of that soil for God. And I don't feel like just Donnie from Chattanooga, Tennessee originally. I live in Texas. But I don't feel like just this little country boy that used to preach on the street, the only place I had to preach. I don't feel like it's just this little boy walking in. I walk in as a servant of the Lord. Not proud. Not stuck up. But walk in as the anointed vessel of God. I've come to take your country for Jesus Christ. I came in this place tonight to bless you. I didn't come here just to get up and talk in front of you. I came here to see you changed and see the power of God fall on you. Well, this guy came in and gave his heart to God. And he wanted me to just keep giving him money. Well, I gave him money, but I told him, I said, yeah, I'm not your source. God's your source. If you're called a pastor, you build a church and God, but we don't have the money here y'all have in America. Y'all got all that money in America. I said, oh, God loves Americans more than he loves you. Why'd you get saved? Why are you preaching? If you believe God loves me more than he loves you, well, then why'd you accept the call? I mean, I was nice to him when I said it, but the bottom line was still the same. I said, you believe God. You know, he built a $5 million church without help from the United States, debt-free. Got thousands of people there right now. I got a kid over there in one of those countries. I can't turn my phone on sometimes. He's just firing at me, just wanting to talk. And I won't answer my phone because I won't get off. But, you know, he sends me these texts and he sends me emails. And I was somewhere eating supper the other night. He started firing at me. But you know what? He came in one of my meetings and God touched his heart and changed him. And out of all the thousands of people, I just said, come up here, young man. I didn't know that he had been in that country. I'd been to 26 different cities. And I didn't know that he had been coming to these meetings. And I told him, I said, you've been very discouraged, but you're talented, you're anointed, and God's going to use you. But you know what? He's filling up arenas with young people. I mean, arenas. And he called me. He said, would you come and do a youth meeting? I said, do what? He said, will you come and speak in one of my youth meetings? I said, do what? I said, youth? I said, I'm not a kid anymore. You're the kid. You're the one that does all that fancy stuff and all them lights and all of that. I said, I don't know how to do that stuff. He said, no. He calls me Dad. He said, Dad, just come and let the Holy Ghost flow. Well, I went and there was young people in the bleachers. I mean, the young people was everywhere, you know. Well, I just said, God, you got to help me. Well, you know what I did? You know what I did? I just fell down on the floor and started doing push-ups. Sure did. I mean, I just went and went and went. They're all looking, who is this crazy guy doing? But God let me use that to get their attention. And when I did, the Holy Ghost, I began to preach for about 15, 20 minutes. I don't know how long it was, but the Holy Ghost fell. There wasn't a dry eye. And them young people just almost ran over to one another to get down to the front to give their heart and life to the Lord Jesus Christ. And he's doing it all over. He's doing it all over. I'm telling you, you know, when you do something for God, it impacts people's lives. See, Nicolette, God's impacting you. He's impacting you, and He's healing you, and He's fixing some things that you can't fix on your own, and He's going to restore some things that's been taken. So I want to tell you tonight that you might be sitting here and people looking at you and me and thinking that you and me are the only one having church, but you just go ahead and bask in the goodness of God, because it's going to get better. God's healing you. He's healing some situations. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I'd rather be in His presence. I'd rather be in His presence than anything the world has to offer. There's nothing like the presence of God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. You know, 20 years ago in Fort Worth, Texas, I went to a meeting. This young guy was preaching, and I took several men of God with me, and so they, when I came in, they recognized me and brought me to the front row, which I didn't want. But I kept looking at my watch, and we got there about 10 o'clock, and meeting started at 10, but I kept looking at my watch at noon, and nobody was even thinking about closing. It went to 12:30, went to 1, went to 1:30, and I was already having appointments that I wasn't being able to show up for. And got to 2, and I thought, when is this going to be over? At about 2:30, the power of God just fell in that room. The power of God fell in that room. And I was lying on the floor weeping in the presence of God. And this young guy that was preaching told me later, "You used to teach me on video. And here it is now, you're sitting in my meeting and I get to pray for you." Isn't that something, how God will put you at the right place at the right time? This was a nobody that God brought. A nobody that God brought. Put them in a particular place and the Holy Ghost fell and it changed their life forever. Now it's changed multitudes of people. I don't know what's going to happen in your life tonight if you don't put those walls up. But if you'll just let go. See, I see somebody stuck. I see somebody else you're stuck. Let me tell you a story. And I know I'm not used to real long meetings anymore, but I know every one of you will understand this because you know it, but have you ever gone to a circus and watched these huge elephants that's got a little stake in the ground that you can actually almost pull it out? But those elephants, huge, all they got to do is that will come out of the ground, but they won't pull it out. Do you know why they won't pull it out? They think they're stuck. They don't know. All they have to do is yank that real hard and it'll come out of the ground. Because when they was young, a big stake was driven into the ground. A big chain was tied around it. A big chain was put around their legs. And they pulled and they pulled and they pulled and they pulled. And they pulled and they pulled and they couldn't break free. So one day, mentally, they gave up. And every time a chain is put around them, their mind goes back to when they couldn't get loose. They're free and they don't know they're free. Jesus has made you free, but something happened in your life that you're still letting it chain you like the elephants. I believe God sent me to you. Come up here. Don't bother about who else is here. Come on up here and get out of that. Come on out here. Just come up here and stand. Ushers, you're going to have to help me now. That's it. Just come on. Because God sent me to you. God sent me to you. Thank you, Lord. Don't you sense the presence of God? It's just still. It's just still, but the presence of God's in this room.